Wavesound Audiobooks presents an unabridged recording of My Sweet Guillotine, written and narrated by Jayne Tuttle. For Matt and Frankie. La brume laisse à l'imagination le soin de terminer l'image. Fog leaves the imagination to complete the image. Jacques Lecoq. Vertigo. There's a time of day in the Rue du Château d'Eau when the low sun hits the narrow street so fiercely you're blinded and have to keep walking until the world returns to you. If you were to stop during the blind out, you'd remain in a state of sightlessness and be bumped by a pram, a dog, or an older gent coming from the other direction who, oblivious to your inability to see, will huff and curse "fish you" beneath his breath. When I first walked down this street and the blinding happened, the incapacity to see stopped me in my tracks. But now, delirious from a 21-hour flight, I stride into the abyss, the rays reminding my jet-lagged body it is day, the smell of smoke and piss and burnt corn telling me I'm back. My heart races in the blindness. Not just for the thrill of the void, but for fear of being bumped. The break has healed, the doctors say, but the terror put into me about the consequences of the slightest neck movement has stayed in my body. As my sight returns, the figures and buildings in front of me are cast in silhouette. Then colour gradually seeps back, rendering the garbage trucks and cars and motors and people more crisp and bright than ever. My heartbeat slows. What is different? I am different. Nothing is different. I am not different. I turn onto the Rue du Faubourg Saint-Denis, the street I spent almost every day on for 2 years. The Napoleon is still there with shiny new tables, the tabac press, the mouton blanc, the Château d'Eau bar with the oars still out so the sign reads shut. It's like I never left. Never finished theatre school, never moved to the 20th, never got near beheaded. Never spent 4 months in Australia being nursed by my dad. I am always on this street. Even in Australia for those months, I was always here in Bosch's garden of earthly delights, the mess of bodies in all their lives, busy, bored, mad, sad. When I closed my eyes, I could see every shopfront, every doorway. Because I walked it, perhaps. When you walk, you see. I thought Nadine would suggest we meet elsewhere, somewhere not so familiar, so full of recent memories, but I didn't argue. There's always reason to Nadine's rhyme. It does make sense to re-enter Paris from this place, I suppose, where I was happy not so long ago, far from any memory of the 20th and what happened. Where every day I'd rush to school in my theatre blacks, where Nadine and I and Adrian and Kiki and Harry and our theatre school friends would eat and drink and loiter. The parties. The pigeons, the people, always people in your way. Myself, right now, in a street mirror, a being in shards. Someone else. So thin she looks almost Parisian, but for the pale ex-hospital vibe. Face not on quite right. I step in closer. It's normal to do that here, check one's lipstick, one's hair, mirrors everywhere to remind us we exist. The chin scar is like a sucked noodle squashed into the bottom of my face. I have to bring my lower lip upwards to notice it properly, but it does look like I have a permanent small piece of food stuck to my chin. The part where my teeth came through the skin below my lip is still a jagged black line. For some reason it stayed black, even after they removed the stitches. The pièce de résistance. The scar that lightning bolts from my ear down my cheekbone is still very visible, though less so with my hair down like this. I pull my hair back and turn my head to one side. The sun catches the damaged cheekbone and the sides of the cuts, highlighting the crevices. Badass, I tell myself. You're a badass scar-faced bitch. Rock that scar, you badass. I cover it back up with hair. No students outside the theatre school smoking cigarettes, leaning on bikes. Classes must be finished for the day or, being Friday, Everyone is inside watching autocours, or perhaps rehearsals for a soirée, the students in blacks, the profs with their legs crossed. I walk up to the old blue door and touch the small gold plaque that reads École Internationale de Théâtre Jacques Lecoq, as though pressing it will make something happen. Time turn back, a new world emerge. Nothing happens. It's just a plaque. I peer through a gap in the door, no movement in the walkway. I always thought I'd miss school intensely after I finished, but I hadn't, not a bit. Nostalgia implies unfinished business or something you can't have again that you want. I had left every living, breathing scrap of myself inside that grande salle, that salle verte, those sweaty, sticky halls in front of those cutting, discerning teachers. There'd be nothing to miss. My hands tremble. Funk of plain food in my mouth, jet lag blinking me in and out of reality. Should have gone to sleep for a bit at Nadine's, like she said, though Kiki insists it's always better on arrival day to try and see it through, at least until dark. Nadine said to meet her at 6 as she hurried out the door, after meeting me on the canal and taking me up the 7 flights of stairs to her new flat, if you can call it that. A carpeted walkway with a shower, no kitchen, and 2 tiny rooms with a roof so low you almost have to crawl. I said Belleville. She said Jeanette. She likes their chicken salad. I said, who would eat at Jeanette with the kitchen so close to that rancid toilet? But she said it's good as she pulled on her shoes, and once Nadine gets an idea in her mind, there's no budging it. She set her alarm loud for 5 p.m. and told me, sleep. But I was afraid I would never wake up and miss these precious days of homecoming. 5 days in Paris, a month in Portugal on the play. Then a month's residency back here at the Recollet, my old home, thanks to the sponsorship Murray France secured for the play from the Ville de Paris. Enough time to find a new flat before la rentrée, a little place of my own, even a chambre de bonne. I lay on Nadine's mattress and took her ibuprofen and took in her world. It felt good to be back, but not quite, yet. Things of mine were scattered through the place amongst hers, my blue vase, my green fern, my red chair, my throne. The thought of my things having a life in Paris without me was disconcerting. I tried not to be nostalgic about them. Couldn't sleep. I got up, showered, put on clothes, took them off, pulled on a green dress of Nadine's from a pile at the end of the bed, and wound my thick brown winter scarf around my neck until it was comfortably tight. Then I walked carefully down her slippery stairs and out along the Quai de Jemappes, over the Bridge of Atmosphere, and up past the Recollet, thought of going in and saying hello to Chantal, decided not yet, and cut down the alleys towards the boulevard, taking my time, looking up. I walked these streets for years and never looked up. You don't look up. You're in too much of a hurry. And also, when you were here as an au pair at 22, you looked up so much you were seen as a tourist and men pinched your butt. On the corner of Château d'Eau and Strasbourg, I stopped at Kiki's tree, the artwork she pointed out once that I'd passed 1,000 times without noticing. Kiki always looked up. She never graduated from tourist and was not about to let some butt-pinching dick ruin her moment. The painting is an exact replica of the tall plane tree planted into the concrete in front of it. Such a work, and so easy to miss on the crammed, polluted boulevard. As the plane tree changes through the seasons, the painted memory of itself at its leafiest endures behind it. Now summer full, the tree and its image were in perfect symmetry. Kiki's the shadow, me the tree, I thought to myself, imagining Kiki's laughter if I said that out loud. Paris is still not the same without her. I stood too long and looked. I don't care. Pinch my butt. I'm in less danger of having my butt pinched now I'm 31. Femme. Madame. Also, the scars. Chez Jeanette is the same, but cleaner, and Jeanette is gone. That is, if the old woman who tended the bar ever was Jeanette, I just assume she was. Perhaps Jeanette was her favourite movie star. Perhaps it was her mother. There's a young guy behind the bar now, wild, dark curls, that easygoing look of a Parisian who's travelled a lot. He lights a cigarette and I think of lighting one too, but the doctor told me 100% not to, and the image he painted of the smoke going straight to the break in my neck makes me queasy. The toilet is the same. The place is full of Adrians. Old Adrian, book-reading Adrian, girl Adrian. There is no way he would be hanging around the 10th, so it's unlikely I'll actually see him. The thought of him makes my heart thump, not for lust, but the knowledge that if I ever do see him again, I will kill him. Now I can smell him. Habit rouge. Perhaps I'm imagining it. Perhaps it's the guy at the table next to me reading Beckett's Happy Days in English. A Lecoq student, I bet. It's one of my favourite plays. Winnie stuck in her mound day after day, the sun baking down, her little bag with its revolver reminding her and us she can always end it. Where's Nadine? Should have brought a book. Nadine always takes a book everywhere she goes. Why didn't I bring a book? A strong bout of surrealness. I focus on the Kia in front of me, squeeze my eyes awake. The Lecoq guy shifts in his loose black clothes, sending a waft of Adrian my way. I try to ignore the confusion it's creating in me. Anger, nostalgia, sex. Unusual for an Englishman to be wearing habit rouge. Perhaps he's French reading Beckett in English. Doubtful. That guy smells like Adrian, I say to Nadine as she sits down, not apologising for being late. She's not, I suppose, by Paris standards. A glass of Chablis appears in front of her with a glass of nuts. The Beckett guy buries deeper into his book. Forgot he was English and can understand me perfectly. Nadine looks at him and I regret having said anything as she leans towards me and sniffs deep, looking around like a detective. She can't smell anything, she says, but urine cakes and beer. Also, nice dress. She sends her wine back. The fresh glass is better. The new guy, named Greg, doesn't mind at all. Nadine smiles. She's had her blonde hair cut boy short a la Jean Seberg, which suits her petite pixie face. She's less polished than before, more natural, though her teeth are still a brilliant white. She's lost skin. If I put on weight, Adrian would say that I had taken skin. Tu as pris la peau. I wouldn't say either to Nadine. Her skin-lessened face is makeup-free, and she's wearing a red silk tank top, which, in contrast with the neon Chez Jeannette sign behind her head, makes a striking picture. I take a few photos and show them to her. She deletes 3 out of the 4 and hands the camera back to me, lighting a rolly from her crumpled pack of fleurs de pays. It's cool here now, she says. Crowds at night. There are bouncers. Greg turns the music up loud, which I'm grateful for as I don't think I can string another sentence together. Nadine is saying something about Gaulier and someone from her class who's famous now, and I'm glad just to nod, grateful we've taken our lives back up as though nothing happened. She asks if I want to come to Sceaux to watch the Gaulier soirée tomorrow night. I say I can't. I'm writing with Murray France. The Gaulier school is focused on the individual performer, whereas Lecoq is more about collaborative creation. Their shows aren't as fun to watch. I don't tell her this, and it's true about Murray France. I ask if she wants to come to the marionette show on Tuesday, the one I got the job for before the accident. She says no, dolls are creepy. 2 new glasses of wine appear on the table. Bad idea, I smile. Smart, says Nadine. It'll wake you up. She suggests we move to the terrace, and Greg follows with our drinks. Early evening sun bathes our faces. She asks if I'm okay. Must be weird to be back. And I say I'm fine, just a bit laggy. The sun will help, she says, tilting her head back. The chicken salad arrives, delivered by a waiter with a slight amount of snobbery at the unconventional hour at which we're eating it, which Nadine ignores completely. Food will help you stay awake too, she says, asking for another fork, salt and pepper, and hot sauce. And the side of avocado? The salad is delicious, especially with the hot sauce, and has no toilet flavour. She describes her new rude English teaching student and her recent reading at the English bookshop of a short story she wrote that she wants to turn into a play, or perhaps a book. I tell her I started playing with some old notes in Australia that might be a novel. What's it about? She asks. Paris, I don't know. Remember how Adrian translated moths as night butterflies? She tells me I should do a reading at the bookshop like she did. It was so much fun. One day, I say, right now I need to focus on the play. I've only got a few days in Paris to tie up the script with Marie France before Portugal. The Adrian smell guy brushes past us and down the street in a cloud of scent. Oh, yeah, says Nadine, picking up on it. Habit rouge. You know he's engaged, she says. Yes, I tell her, jaw tight. Of course I know. In Dad's spare room on the other side of the world, I harassed him as best I could, delirious on drugs, firing spite via email and text message. I was hung up on why he never came to visit me in the hospital. It was me who had ended it. Well, my bike, turning me around on the way to his place and back towards the rental I'd just been offered on the Rue de la Chine. But still, you were my family in Paris, I seethed at him. It wasn't a scratch. His mother, Severine, never came either. I suspected they thought it was my own fault, which in my shock and delirium drove me insane. Papillon fou, he used to call me. Crazy butterfly. A Swedish chick, Nadine continues. Katarina. Now I know her name. You've met her? My stomach is a knot. I don't want to know about Adrian or Katarina. Nadine is too close to everything. I should have stayed at Harry's, but he's away and his weird flatmate is there. I could have stayed with Marie France, but her boyfriend, and she's pregnant. Nadine is like a sister. I was always going to stay with her, but fuck, now I want to go home. I want to run back to Dad's, get under the scratchy covers and have him pat my head, run my bath, feed me schnitzels. Was I mad to come back so soon? Where am I? Nadine feeds me more chicken salad and she's right. The food is telling my body I'm here, I'm awake. She's meeting some friends on the left bank for apéro and tells me I have to come. I don't want to, but she reinforces Kiki's rule about staying awake as late as possible. My neck throbs. She mounts her bike and I get a velib, feeling a moment of panic that subsides as I push off and muscle memory kicks in. And we're sailing through the marais like we always did, across the river to the cafe opposite Notre Dame, called Panis, which I always called penis in my head. When I tell Nadine, she wrinkles her nose and doesn't laugh. As she's chaining her bike outside the cafe, I find ways to say cafe penis as many times as possible to break her, but she doesn't and finally says, shut up with the cafe penis. And when I ask her why she doesn't think it's funny, she shrugs. It's just not. Now it's even funnier because she doesn't find it funny, and I tell her that, but she's busy rolling a cigarette. Cafe Penis is bustling with tourists eating dinner and Parisians drinking apéro, and down the back near the bar are three pushed-together tables sticky with wine and beer and little bowls of stale popcorn. Nadine introduces me to an Irish guy with a moustache waxed into a curl, an English chick in a polka-dot dress, a French guy in a suit jacket and jeans, and the owner of the English bookshop's daughter, who I've met before. She's an actor and has the same agent as Nadine and I. She pulls a tabouret towards herself, patting it. I heard about your accident, she says. I couldn't believe it. I still can't picture how it happened. You got your head caught in the door of the elevator. The waiter approaches and I order a sez, and as the others talk, I say, no, well, not quite. The more she asks, the more the attention of the table turns my way and I feel my face go hot, the skin prickling around my scar. My hands tingle and my ankles clamp across each other beneath the tabouret. Nadine keeps talking loudly to the French guy in the jacket, perhaps to steer the conversation away from me, but his eyes have turned to me too. And though the bodies are in all different directions, they're listening. It's hard to explain, I say. Sorry, she says. You must hate talking about it. No, it's fine. It feels like something that happened to someone else. There is no way to tell the story in a soundbite, though I had started to formulate a script in Australia after the barrage of questions from friends and family. You fell down the elevator shaft? The elevator fell? You got your head trapped in an elevator? The elevator closed on your head? All eyes are on me now. I take a swig of beer, smile, dissociate, and repeat the script with a light conversational air, though I'm burning with shame. Thank God for the acting training. Jayne. You know the old buildings here with the lifts in the middle of the staircases without protective enclosures around them? Nods, murmurs. Well, it was January. Paris was dark. My friend Sophie lives in a 1930s building in the 20th, and the lights were dim, and the lift moved up and down in total silence, a finger's breadth from the banister. You could touch it. The protective barrier came just up to banister height, which was low, and I'm tall. Plus, I was wearing heels. Sophie's 4-year-old daughter, Lou, called me from below. We were playing a game of hide-and-seek. I was excited to see her after a lonely winter breaking up with my fiancé. I was calling to her, Lou, and she was calling, Jayne. To help her see me, I leant slightly over the rail. She illustrates the angle of the banister with her forearm and moves her head over as if to look down. I could see Lou's face below. She puts her other hand above her head as if to show the descending elevator. And I didn't realise that I'd put my head in the path of the descending elevator. English chick, hand over mouth. Oh my God. Moustache guy. Whoa. Jayne. Luckily the lift stopped and I managed to pull my head out from beneath. Nadine. A miracle. English chick. I feel sick. The bookseller's daughter. How did the lift stop? Jayne. I don't actually know. French guy, shaking his head.
Always so many accidents in Paris in these old buildings.
The bookseller's daughter. Unbelievable. English chick. Then what happened? Jayne. I don't know exactly. I blacked out and fell down the staircase. English chick. But you pulled your head out? Jayne. Yes, but I don't remember any of it. I came to on the stairwell after I fell down a flight of stairs. The bookseller's daughter. But you were okay. Jayne. Yeah, well, kind of. I was lucky. They didn't realise until later that I'd broken my cervical spine, my neck. Nadine. They put her in a soft collar to carry her to the hospital. A soft collar! If she'd moved her head in any way, she could have died or been paralysed. Sorry, Janie, is this... Jayne. It's fine. I'm just glad to have survived. I just had some broken bones in my face and the neck fracture, which they didn't even have to operate on. Nadine. Because she was so young and fit from all the acrobatics at Lecoq. Moustache guy. All that falling training. The bookseller's daughter. Was there any other damage? Jayne. Not really. I was lucky to keep my ear. And there's this major artery there, the carotid artery, that can be fatal. I had this amazing surgeon that stitched up my face with thousands of the tiniest stitches. Moustache guy. And what did they do about your neck? Jayne. They put me in this new kind of brace thing, a corse minerve, it's called. Nadine. Like a robot contraption. She was suffocating. Jayne. It was okay. I got used to it. The bookseller's daughter. In England, they put bolts in your head, you know, with the poles, the scaffolding. Nadine. Australia, too. English chick. You were in rehab? Jayne. I would have been, but my sister, who's a nurse, came and took me back to Australia to recover with my dad in his cottage by the sea. I've literally just arrived back. Nadine, patting Jane's arm. She's recovered amazingly. English chick. Are you okay now? Do you have pain? The bookseller's daughter. You can barely see the scars. French guy. Why did you come back? I tell them about the play, and they all say they'll come when it's on in Paris and break off into smaller conversations. My throat feels tight and my head won't stay still. The sounds of the restaurant are loud in my ears but strangely muted at the same time, and my eyes keep fixing on the reverberations of light from the street lamp outside. I'm cool, so cool, all good, smiling, laughing at Nadine, who is mimicking her rude student. My body feels like it's moving in the way you feel when you get off a boat. The darkening street outside is the deck of a ship. My head is in the sky, on the stairwell, asleep in the sea. I'm so jet-lagged, Nadine, I whisper after an appropriate amount of time has passed after the accident story, that my departure won't seem dramatic. I have to go.
Don't go.
I need to go. I have that vertigo jet-lag feeling that I'm going to black out right here in the popcorn. Will you be okay to ride by yourself?
Of course.
Okay, but you'll need to let me in later. I'll leave the key under the mat. I fear I'll be unwakeable.
Okay, good idea.
She closes my hand around the key with her warm, slightly sticky hand and gives me a serious look. Ride safe. There's only one velib left, and a young guy and I approach the stand at the same time. He steps aside in an unusually chivalrous move. Velibs are dog-eat-dog. Perhaps he can see I'm about to collapse into a pile of dust.
Merci.
De rien.
He walks away, lighting a cigarette. I get on the bike and push off slowly, Paris swirling around me in a dusky haze. Halfway across the Pont du Châtelet, I stop to breathe and wait for the world to stop spinning. Out past Notre Dame, the lights are on, the sun shooting a final pink dart through the night sky. I try to remember the moment at 22 when down there on the riverbank I first saw the view for myself. The flash of independence I got in that moment had stayed with me, the feeling that I didn't need to be with someone else to truly experience something, that the world could exist entirely within me. It was that moment that had led me back here after Mum died, looking for that feeling again of being whole while entirely alone. Someone laughs. I turn around. A woman my age runs to catch up with her boyfriend. She wasn't laughing at me. Maybe it was me laughing at me. The conciergerie looms over the river, its ghoulish facade containing the ghost of Marie Antoinette waiting her turn at the guillotine. I've never been able to look at those conical towers without seeing her in there, in her nightgown, with her hair chopped off, sitting by a candle, writing her last letter. Perhaps I saw that in a documentary. I wonder what it feels like knowing you're going to get your head cut off. I'm grateful that if mine had been, I wouldn't have seen it coming. I ride off towards the Marais. Ghosts everywhere. Adrian in the Place du Châtelet kissing me in the snow. Kiki laughing in bars along the Rue de Rivoli. Nadine dancing in dress shops. Marie-France leaning from her old window in the Rue du Poitou. Harry skateboarding in République. My student friends picnicking on the cobblestoned edges of the canal. Ghosts from the accident, the flashes of light, the stairwell, the purple feeling in the back of the ambulance, the smell of sulphur, the sensation of my own face flesh being peeled back to touch itself, the ambulance lights strobing the walls of someone else's party, me at the party, wondering who's in the ambulance and what happened to them. Nadine's building looms over the murky canal, the facade dark and silent and ugly. It's allowed to be with those views. Who cares what something looks like as long as it's looking at something beautiful? That thought comforted me when my face was bad and I thought my body was done for. I fumble in my pocket for Nadine's key and pull out something triangular, grey and plastic. My head is quicksand. I stand staring at the strange yet familiar object. Giddy, it occurs to me what the object is. It's come all the way from Australia. Nadine doesn't know about M. I haven't made a point of telling her, and it's not like it would come up. Oh, by the way, since your monumental breakup, near beheading and recovery in a neck brace at your dad's, met anyone? Anyway, it's not like I met someone. I just met someone. Nadine is snoring. I leave a note saying I've gone out for pastries, which is half true. I'm not sure why I'm half lying. I don't have words for M yet. He is kind on the phone and laughs at me calling it a plucker, saying it's not important at all. He has dozens of plectrums, none are special. I keep waiting for him to sigh, say, oh, merde, tell me to be more mindful, call me papillon fou. He says his plane leaves for Portugal on Friday week, right after the final gig with his band. He asks about my flight, Nadine, what it's like to be back in my old neighbourhood, what my plans are for the day, describe where I'm sitting. I tell him I don't think I've ever seen the canal this early. Chez Prune isn't open. The street sweepers are out. The sky is clear. It's going to be a pretty day. I love the smell of Paris in early summer, the mix of pollution and pollen. I ask where he is right now. He describes the servo on High Street, some guy filling up his car with the window down, a Metallica blaring, the smell of old sausage rolls. The call cuts out and he messages to say, talk soon. I try to imagine him here on the canal and can't. Du Pain et des Idées is shut. Damn, I forgot their close on Saturdays. The most popular boulangerie in the neighbourhood, and they shut on weekends. La vie est belle. I have to go to the one on the Rue du Château d'Eau, which Nadine likes better anyway, their pain au chocolat, more traditional and soggy with butter. She eats just the passage where the chocolate lies and the bit of pastry around it, leaving the flaky outer bits still on the paper. She's always done this. I asked her once if it was a dietary thing. She didn't answer, but went on talking about the other thing she was talking about, as she always does when I annoy her. There is a queue around the corner and up the Rue du Château d'Eau. My neck is killing me. Nadine's lumpy oreiller, her sausage pillow, wasn't enough on the futon mattress on the floor. It hurt less with her winter jumper folded up on top and sleeping in my scarf, but still. When my neck is bad, I can't help thinking of the story my sister Kate told me about a man who has a head-on collision on the highway. He crawls from the wreckage, the sole survivor, and manages to walk to a nearby house. There's been an accident, he tells the person at the door. Where? They ask. Over there, says the man, turning his head to indicate. And he falls down dead. He had a C2 fracture, non-displaced, just like mine. If he'd kept his head forward, he'd probably have been fine. I pull the scarf tighter as I wait in the queue, grateful to have an appointment with Berenice, the kinesitherapeut, before Portugal. I think she translates as physio, but she's far stranger than that. I've missed her. All the stuff I've put in place here, health card, bank card, phone, carte de séjour, kiné, piles and piles of paperwork. I'd stay here forever simply because of all the hard work it took to get set up. The queue is stuck. A ray of sun is baking the top of my head. As I put my hand up to cover the part in my hair, a drop of water hits the back of my hand, which gives me a shock. I step back. A woman on the fourth floor is watering her basil plant. She catches my eye and disappears behind her rusty balcony. How many people die each year by falling pot plant? I would really like to know. I can see dozens up there, proud on their balconies. With age, weather, time, who knows, at some point they could drop. How many per year? Is there a list at the commissariat? Would they show me? The queue is still not moving. The drips are creating a small pool on the concrete. A man approaching the queue stops and tousles his hair, looks up, huffs. Are there laws around pot plants? Regulations on spacing, height? Are you supposed to strap them in? I saw Severine do that once, replace an old strap that was fraying. Do straps break? Gusts knock? Do old pots suddenly give way for no reason at all? What a coincidence to be that person below. If only he'd left the office a second later, earlier, hadn't taken the boulevard. If only he hadn't stopped to buy a pain au chocolat. We shuffle forward a few inches. Sitting ducks for a pot plant. Small, large, terracotta, worn. A long plastic tub of geraniums, the slut of the window box, Kiki would say. I like geraniums. They're more of a nana plant to me than a slut. They were the only things that would survive on my small balcony in the Recollet, colour all year round. Adrian stubbed his cigarettes, his clops, in their dirt, and still they survived. I was never in danger of killing anyone by pot plant in the Recollet. My window looked out over the park and below was a cobblestone driveway locked off to the public. I think I would be afraid, on a narrow street like here on the Rue du Château d'Eau, that my plant would fall on someone, even if it was well secured. In the Rue de la Chine, I had two window boxes and a small ledge outside the kitchenette where I put cheeses. In the window boxes, I planted a geranium and some roses and I didn't tie the pots in. I never thought of it. My flat was on the first floor anyway, so I don't think the pots could have killed anyone unless the entire balcony fell off. Has anyone's balcony ever fallen off? If the cheeses fell, they wouldn't have harmed anyone. Though now I think of it, frozen in winter, a hard cheese, say, like a conte, could cause a nasty concussion. Getting killed by falling brie, now that would be a story. At the counter, finally, the change machine was en panne. For the life of me, I can't understand these machines that take your cash and give you change while the lady is right there. They always jam. There's always a problem. And seriously, is it that hard to put the money through the till? Is it a hygiene thing? Or an accuracy thing? It comes across like the boulangerie owner doesn't trust the staff to handle cash. It feels inhuman and quite un-French. Though as soon as I think that, then I think it's very French. Everything you say about the French is always true in its exact opposite. I suppose you could say that about most cultures. I suppose I shouldn't generalise. Back at Nadine's, the sun is shining across her mattress in a stripe and her quilt smells good, that sisterly smell of thyme and old shampoo. We lie in the stripe and she doesn't bring up the accident or Adrian, and I'm grateful to talk about current things like the play and her English students and the new Italian restaurant on the Rue Marie-Louise and the upcoming summer vide-grenier on the Place Saint-Martre, my favourite, which I'll miss. She has a new boyfriend, a French guy called Didier, and I laugh because the guy in French textbooks in school was always called Didier, and I never thought anyone would actually be called that. She smiles when I say this, although she doesn't find it funny. It's so hard not to needle her. I resist asking, does he wear a beret? Does he know où est la piscine? Does he like the summertime? My things look at home here. The stained red velvet chair I bought from the Marché aux Puces with Kiki that made me feel shabby regal in my Spartan room in the Recollet. I can see Adrian sitting on it right now, naked, smoking. His tea towel I stole. The handmade vase Severine gave me for my 30th that lived next to my bed in the Rue de la Chine. My things assimilate naturally into Nadine's environment with all the random objects she's gathered from brocantes and vide-greniers and the puce. She has an innate honing device that leads her consistently to gems. Like Kiki, she can spot the potential in things and her feelings about them are instantly laser clear. Perhaps that's why I don't want to mention M just yet. I'm not sure what she might say. I got to know Nadine better after school was over. Her eccentricities had kept me at a distance at first. For example, she is a long orderer, and she sends things back, wine, meals, coffee, several times if necessary. And she always wants to move seats mid-meal to be in the better spot. For someone as afraid of offending waiters as I am, this was a challenge. But over time I came to realise she was just incredibly motivated to make the most out of every moment. She wasn't desperate like I was to become French, to disappear into the culture. And of course they liked her and found me a suck and a fake. And there you'd be, in the perfect place. The one blinding ray of winter sunshine in the whole of Paris shining across your table. And you're eating a burger with the sauce from the steak dish in it. Or drinking a Perrier rondelle with 3 slices of lemon, or the perfect glass of wine she accepted on the 4th go, and her hair is shining in the sun, her water fizzing into the sky, extra ice please, and she has read something fascinating, and she has just landed an ad for toothpaste, dentifrice, and she is content like a cat. She isn't afraid to ask for what she wants. She knows who she is and what she likes, and she doesn't like poo-poo jokes. She likes me despite this. I remember her at my hospital bed, warm hand on mine. I remember it like a film. The girl in the bed looks like the elephant man in a swollen state of shock. Jayne. Do I look like a freak? Nadine. No. Just like you've been in a very bad car accident. Flowers were forbidden, but the ones she brought were grandiose, from her favourite guy on the Rue Grandjean-Belle, who sleeps up on a ledge in his shop. Winter wildflowers in powder blues, whites and yellows. I can only imagine how long it took her to choose them, have him perfectly wrap them. Non, pas ce ruban-là, celui-là, le violet. Non, 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 on recommence. There was no way these flowers weren't staying in my room, and my darling nurse Noémie, looking in Nadine's determined face, didn't put up a fight. She put them on top of a cupboard where I could see them if I squinted hard enough. Nadine faded in and out with the injections of liquid love in my thighs, the sweet pinch that kept me in fairyland. She was there the day I was fitted with the Cosse Minerve, which I nicknamed the cage. It was like being inserted into my own personal prison, with no air between my flesh and the bars. I was weaned brutally off the love. I wanted to die then. It was worse than the pain, this nausea, this wanting to throw off my own body. Nadine sat beside me as I lay in the shadows. She knew not to touch me and not to speak. I loved her more than ever then, for her staying, her stillness, her silence, her ability to listen to me though I wasn't speaking. I did have family in Paris, other than Adrian and Severine. We lie around all morning on her quilt, eating the pastries. She eats 3 chocolate middles and talks about Didier, the new yoga school she's discovered in the Rue du Faubourg Poissonnière, the ridiculous auditions Daphne Papps, our agent, has sent her to. She asks if I've told her I'm back, and I say, no, I'm not back yet, and also I'm not sure about my acting future. There's a lot of voiceover work around now, Nadine tells me, doing audiobooks and radio ads in French with the little English touch. It's fashionable. She asks about Portugal and whether I feel comfortable directing, and I tell her of course not, I'd much rather be performing, but I can't be in a situation where I might be bumped. The doctors say I need to avoid unpredictable physical activities for at least the next 6 months, and acting is the most unpredictable physical activity there is, apart from sex, perhaps. I never know what my body might do in either situation, so both are out of the question right now. Though my libido hasn't been affected by the accident, au contraire, regular orgasms, I've been telling myself, will heal my bones faster. Nadine does not want to know about this. She is very interested, however, in the things I don't want to talk about, like if I feel strong enough to be back in the theatre, where I will live once the play is over, whether I'll go back to teaching the students I had before the accident, if I'll study again, how I'll make money. I don't want to think about the future. I don't want to think. I keep having flashbacks to the separation from Dad at the airport, the tearing feeling of being a toddler sent off to school too early. Nadine presses more and more into the wounds, requiring more detail, not satisfied with my rote responses or attempts to shrug something off. How are you going to go with that gang in Portugal? Fine, I tell her, though I know what she's getting at. We're not used to the traditional writer-director-actor structure. At Lecoq, we always collaborated, and Nadine knows all about Dublin and the show Tez and I developed using a script of mine called The Cherry Dress, a piece about 2 mad sisters whose mother had died. Sort of Grey Gardens, but 2 young women. We worked off my writing but devised a mostly physical piece around it, which actually made the script even more personal and somehow even more my writing. When a local radio interviewer asked who wrote the piece, Tez had responded, "The two of us." This had made me furious. She hadn't understood the work behind the writing or the way my words had informed our physical piece. I tell Nadine that after Murray France asked me to direct the play, I made every member of the group confirm before I came that I was to be credited as director and writer and that all final decisions would be mine. What about the script? Are you going Beckett on it? I laugh. I still want to give them room to move. Not like in Happy Days, every gesture marked. Another heavenly day! Pause. Smile. Look at bag. Look up. No, she insists. No room to move. We're from Lecoq, I say. They will stab me if I try to dictate. Go Franco on that shit. They'll eat you alive. It'll be fine. Marie France is working on the script with me. Nadine is not convinced, but senses subject closed and turns her questioning to my recovery at Dad's. Her apartment feels wonky, like it might fall off its perch. I'm so jet-lagged, I say, but she continues to press. My head won't stay still. It's driving me crazy, and my heart keeps speeding up and slowing down, my stomach churning. Memories of the accident are returning with the smell of the wood in her floors, the detergent in her towels, the damp funk of the caniveau running below her building, up through Belleville, past the Père Lachaise, to the Rue Pelleport, to that dark stairwell on the night of January 18. As Nadine goes to ask another question, she checks her watch and jumps up. Oops, Going to be late. I fall back in the sheets and close my eyes, grateful for the silence. I'm on the stairwell, flying out over it in slow motion. Something cold on my neck. I wake with a start. My heart pounds. My head is a brick. Breathe. In for 4. Hold for 7. Out for 8. In for 4. Hold for 7. Out for 8. Paris. Nadine's. Saturday. I think I'll be falling down that staircase forever. Nadine's lampshade, full of dead insects. My neck so stiff I can barely move it. 4 p.m. The panic subsides. I lie and touch the right side of my face. The numbness beneath the scars, they say, is permanent. Dead skin, dead face. Flattened affect. Difficult to act with a face that's half numb. Nobody seems able to tell, and I can't notice when I look in the mirror. Strange to see one thing and feel another. Nadine has a small bar fridge. 1 egg and an old bourbon, noodles floating in a bowl of scum. The sun is bright. My phone beeps. 3 messages. Murray France.
Come at 5 o'clock.
Harry. Back tonight. Carry on tomorrow. M. A square erupted, taking in live ballet move. 9 letters. Arabesque. Such a pretty word. It takes me only 10 minutes to solve. I'm astonished my brain worked so fast, let alone at all. It's easier when you have no expectation of yourself, like when you're drunk. Your brain softens and you can see it quicker. M agrees with this, but he also...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.